Tribute video of German politician Hermann Scheer. Hermann Scheer almost on his own started the solar revolution in Germany, which provided the high-cost seed funding that enabled the gigawatt world solar industry to develop up to what it is today.
People believe that renewable energies would not be enough to substitute atomic or fossil energies, because it is told to them. And the big energy interests of today involved in fossil and atomic energy tell that. And people don't have enough mistrust. They don't know the distinction between an economic interest and an expert. An expert who should be neutral to the different energy sources. And that renewable energies would not be enough to replace conventional energies is an existential lie. Many expectations to this climate conferences. Renewable energies, you can more to a technology market. All costs for renewables are costs for technology. And this creates another economy. And this other economy is much more modern.
If we look to the real problem, if we tell the truth about the energy situation in the world, we have to recognize that there is a decreasing curve of reserves, and it decreases faster the more the energy consumption increases. If we have a decreasing curve and an increasing curve of demands and a decreasing of possible supplyings, then we approach to a crossing point of both curves. If you would arrive at this point, the world would get the most brutal, bloody conflict ever happened. Because without energy, nothing works. Nothing is possible. And on the way to this crossing point, there will be many, many conflicts. The time of energy wars has begun. Not whether the Gulf War nor the Iraq War would have happened if there would be the plantation of bananas instead of the extraction of oil at the Arabian Peninsula. There's no doubt about that. Approach to this curve, to this crossing point of the two curves, then energy will become more and more expensive for all. It creates a social problem for all countries. That means we are in a race against time. And this race against time is not really contradictible. So running out is shorter than many people think. And then the conventional experts confirm. And they don't confirm it because the answer is too radical for them, which should be given to that. If we look to the oil reserves, we can expect that the liquid oil reserves will run out in the next roughly four decades. Roughly four decades. The natural gas reserves are not longer. That means we have to replace these energy sources in the run of the next three or four decades. And this is the challenge of the century. This is the unique challenge since the beginning of civilization. Because without energy, nothing works, nothing can move. It is an existential question. And the contrast between that question, between that challenge, for instance, the movie of Al Gore. I think it is a problem itself to show such a dramatic danger and not to show in the same time a solution. Because what will happen with the people who are aware of that? And if they are not aware about the opportunity or the possibility to come to a solution to overcome this danger, some may become active. But a silent majority, this is a normal historical experience, the silent majority will react in a total other way. They feel confirmed themselves that this problem can never become solved. And if they think that, they develop no future mentalities. They become apathetic. They start to live from day to day as long as possible in the used way, in the usual way, or they become nihilistic. And a society can only create the power, the creativity, can only start to overcome a danger if a perspective is seen, only then, on socio-psychological reasons. It is necessary not to leave a society alone with the danger. It is necessary to show the perspective. That means it is necessary to show that it's possible, that there is a possibility to replace nuclear and fossil energy supply in general by renewable energies. This is the challenge, to show that, to give an example which inspires others to do the same. We shall not wait for international negotiations. We have now within 35 years experiences of global energy conferences and environment conferences. Most of these conferences have only one result. This is a decision for organizing a follow-up conference. And at the same time, you have a rapid growth of the drama. And the number of participants increases, but the results are too low. And this is based on a wrong premise. The wrong premise of all these world climate conferences and other conferences is that the way from the conventional energy system as the source of the problems, the way to energy efficiency, and finally the way to another energy source, to renewable energies, that means to renewable energies, this way would be an economic burden. And therefore, such an economic burden should be carried by all or by none. This is a philosophy. And what is estimated as a burden leads to the bazaar of international negotiations and leads to the trying to get a broad consensus. And the broad consensus, this trying, is in a deep contradiction. Methodologically, in a deep contradiction to the needs to have speed. It's in a deep, unbridgeable contradiction. And there is no example in history of modern technologies since 200 years in which a new technology which creates a new paradigm based on other calculations, which creates new opportunities, apart from the former experiences. There's no example in history that a breakthrough of a technology came by an international treaty. Not one example. And therefore, we need the organization wherever there is enough human power to do that. Enough ambitions, enough commitment, the organization of such a dynamic process. We started that in this sense in Germany.
Of beginning of a technological revolution, mainly in Germany, based on a policy
based on the political, we can come to a new age better for simple. But it is only possible if people use this chance, if they become active, if the, we can activate the society.
If we would continue at the same speed, then there is no rational reason why we should or could not do it. If we would continue at the same speed, we would arrive in 20 years at 100% renewables.
Present energy suppliers, the present energy trusts, the companies, they should organize the transformation. And this is a big mistake. A big mistake. Because this part of the society is the only one who has an interest to postpone it. The only one. All the others have an interest to speed it up. But of corruption, the most comfortable way to corrupt a politician is the method, a legal method, to pay them later. After leaving the government, then hiring him for the board. And this is a very popular, yeah, a very usable way of, let's say, legalized corruption. The Gulf War would not have happened and even not the Iraq War, if there would be the plantation of bananas in Iraq instead of the. It is a structural fight. It is a fight between centralization and decentralization, between energy dictatorship and energy participation and energy democracy. 90% support against all the disinformation campaigns. They have much more money and the possibilities to influence the public opinion. And if it, or they must conquer these states.
To create more local democracy. And it brings a value add, an economic value add to the regions and to the local municipalities. And this leads to a broader distribution of the income and the welfare of a state without bureaucracy. That means the macroeconomic benefits are tremendous. The change from the non-renewable, exhausting and polluting energy sources to renewable, non-polluting and not exploitable energy sources. This is the challenge of this century. And not in the, for the second half of the century, it is a challenge for the next 2 decades.
Also für 2 bis 3 Cent produzieren und aber 10 bis 13 Cent Strompreis verlangen, wo ist denn dann die Preisgestehung? Was ist der Grund? Der Grund ist, dass eben der weit überwiegende Teil, 70, 75, teilweise 80% des Strompreises schon Netzbenutzungskosten sind. Und das heißt, es wird kräftig verdient am Netz.
Eine zunehmende Fixierung der gesamten Willensbildung, geradezu ein Verlagern, ein Ausquartieren der politischen Willensbildung an die Medien, der Verwechslung von öffentlicher Meinung mit tatsächlichen Meinungen. Die Basis von uns sind doch nicht die Medien, sondern die Basis ist die allgemeine Bevölkerung, die genauso skeptisch geworden ist gegenüber dem, was in den Medien steht, was ja zu zunehmenden Entfremdungen auch längst geführt hat. Und wenn wir die Frage beantworten wollen, wie wir fatalsten Denkfehler. Es gibt eine soziologische Mitte. In dieser soziologischen Mitte gibt es progressive Kräfte, die nachdenken. Die müssen wir wiedergewinnen. Die haben wir immer gehabt in den 70er Jahren. Die haben zu den damaligen Wahlerfolgen beigetragen. Aber Polit sagt, die gesagt werden müssten. Wir brauchen deshalb, dass das Allerwichtigste, eine Redemokratisierung der Partei, das macht die Politik produktiver, das macht sie fehlerfreier, das macht sie widerspruchsfreier. Und wir brauchen ergänzend dazu, um nach vorne zu schauen. weiter. Wir brauchen eine zusammenhängende Idee, eine tragende Idee, nur die verbindet. Und eine solche tragende Idee ist möglich. Wir haben doch den praktischen Beweis geliefert. Wir haben viele Wagen wieder.
And we have an increase of the energy consumption in the world, mainly because of the developments in China and India, where 1/3 of world population live. 1/3. And ask about the human potential, and this is the most important thing. To have enough human potential to overcome that problem. Present energy system tends, and its protagonists tend, to prolongate it as long as possible. That means it is impossible to change, to shift from the business being a seller of oil and gas to become a seller of solar radiation and wind. How many resistances come because of that against renewable energies? You can imagine, because the resistances are everywhere. And it became only possible to overcome it by strong policies. Only then. It came never by itself. It was always blocked by the conventional power structures. And moreover, it is a way from few power plants and refineries to many of this system. That means the energy economy is prisoned by its own chain. They cannot leave it. They are dependent from their own business, totally. And if we compare that with the renewable energy supplying, the society and many investors to go straight to renewable energy investments without being dependent in that from the power structure. This is the only way to get success in a short run. And was a guaranteed access to the grid for each power supplier from renewables. Even it is a very small one with a 1 kilowatt peak photovoltaic device. If he wants to sell it for others, and if he needs the grid, he has a guaranteed access to the grid, legally guaranteed. There's no more a way, an opportunity to obstruct it by the power companies. Second, you shall not leave it to the present energy sector. You shall not give them a veto power for the introduction of renewable energies, whether directly nor indirectly. And you must give the incentives for new players. And the general economic view about that is, we can show already a lot of macroeconomic benefits by going to renewables, in contrast to the macroeconomic burdens, increasing macroeconomic burdens of the conventional energies. The macroeconomic benefit into a microeconomic incentives for investors and customers. And if someone follows this line, he can create a dynamic process. And this dynamic process is needed. Energies. And it is a myth. Always new distributed myth that we would need too much time to go to renewables. That is not right. It is totally wrong. Nothing can become implemented faster than renewable energies. Nothing. The 20,000 megawatt
worden. Wir können uns gar nicht mehr leisten, die bekannten Ressourcen, Reserven noch zu verbrennen. Diese globale Pyromanie gefährdet die menschliche Zivilisation. Und es hat einen pathologischen Vorgang. Das ist ein pathologischer Vorgang. Wenn immer man ist, nicht nur aus ökologischen Gründen, in Anführungsstrichen immer nicht nur aus ökonomischen Gründen, nicht nur aus sozialen Gründen, wenn man das künstlich trennen will, genauso aus friedenspolitischen Gründen und aus Gründen einer Gleichwertigkeit, einer Verbesserung der Lebensverhältnisse, eines Abbaus der immer krasser werdenden ökonomischen Disparitäten bzw.
Lebensverhältnis auf diesem Erdball, was ganz entscheidend mit dem herkömmlichen Energiesystem zusammenhängt, was wiederum vielen Energieexperten nicht bewusst ist. Die meisten Energieexperten sind ein Teil des Problems. Deswegen ich dankbar bin, dass ich nicht ohne Energie nicht auskomme. Und die Folge dieser Entwicklung ist zwangsläufig, wir können sie genau verfolgen, der Unterschied zwischen arm und reich in der Weltwirtschaft ist durch diese Energiebereitstellung seit Beginn der industriellen Revolution immer größer geworden und er wird ständig größer. Wer über die Probleme, die Armut, warum denn in die Ferne schweifen, wenn es nahe ist? Warum denn Transportausgaben ausgeben dafür, weil das woanders vielleicht ein bisschen billiger produziert werden kann? Warum denn die Wertschöpfung wieder in die Hand weniger zu geben, wenn man sie selber haben kann? Was ist das für ein ökonomisches Denken, dass Energie, Sonnenstrahlen, Wind, Sonnenwärme, Laufwasserkräfte sind von der Natur kostenlos geliefert. Das sind überirdische Energie. Sie sind da. Sie durchströmen die Ökosphäre des Erdballs. Es ist kein Förderaufwand dafür nötig. Wir müssen sie nur anzapfen. Das heißt, es ist ein Wechsel zu erneuerbarer Energien. Der Oberbegriff dafür ist für mich der solaren Energien. Es sind die einzigen Energien, die den Namen sozial verdienen. Alle anderen können es gar nicht sein. Die einzigen, wenn man so will, linken Energien.
Weltklimakonferenzen ab. Und immer wieder wird alles darauf orientiert und projiziert. Ich vermute, diese ganzen Konferenzen haben schon mehr CO2 mit den 60.000 Teilnehmern, 50.000 Teilnehmern, mehr CO2 verbraucht, als durch deren Ergebnisse nach 15 Jahren Verhandlungen reduziert werden können. Fall für die Solarkraftwerke in der Sahara geben. Das dürfte es dann nicht geben. Das muss man ziemlich genau wissen, was dort, weil dann dürfte man auch nicht sagen, am besten machen wir die ganze Windkraft offshore, auf hoher See. Denn das sind die beiden Ansätze, bei denen eines sichergestellt ist. Das wird dann das Geschäft der großen Stromkonzerne. Und die großen Stromkonzerne, die wissen natürlich genau, dass es zu Ende geht mit dem herkömmlichen Energiesystem. Aber sie haben ein zwingendes, für sich aus sich heraus sogar betriebswirtschaftlich begründbares Interesse. Nämlich Art und Ausmaß und Geschwindigkeit dieses Energiewechsels kontrollieren zu können. Mit anderen Worten, so lange weitermachen zu können wie bisher, wie es irgend möglich ist. Bis zum letzten Tropfen Öl, bis zur letzten Tonne Uran, zur letzten Tonne Kohle, bis zum letzten Kubikmeter. Wir kommen zu kostenlosen Brennstoffen. Damit ist nicht alles kostenlos. Aber wir kommen zu kostenlosen Brennstoffen. Und wir vermeiden die ganzen Primärenergieinfrastrukturen, die Tankschiffe, die Pipelines und so weiter und so weiter und die damit zusammenhängenden Konflikte. Und jeder kann sehen, es ist nur schlecht für die heutigen Verkäufer von Erdöl, Erdgas, Kohle, Uran. Denn die können nicht wechseln in die Rolle des Verkäufers von Sonne und Wind. Weil die Sonne nicht privatisierbar ist und weil keine Shareholder-Möglichkeit gegeben ist.
Wenn die Technik sind, dann heißt das, sie können nur sinken. Mit Massenproduktion und ständigen Laufe. Nichts geht schneller als diese Mobilisierung durch eine Aktivierung der...
Darf ich Ihnen eine schenken?
Ja, okay.
Herzlichen Dank, Herr Dr. Schee.
Tschüss.